McGarg is a senior scientist in the ICES Kidney Dialysis and Transplantation Program. Emmett's been with ICES since 2006. He's also a nephrologist at the London Health Sciences Center, and he's an associate dean at the Schuller School of Medicine and Dentistry at Western University. Scott Garrison is a professor in the Department of Family Medicine at the University of Alberta, and he's also the director of the Pragmatic Trials Collaborative, which you can access at pragmatictrials.ca. Then we have Dr. Kristen Clemens, who's the new site director at ICES Western, and she's also an assistant professor of medicine and epi and biostats at Western, and also practices as an endocrinologist at St. Joseph's Healthcare in London, Ontario. Last but not least, the person who's finally figured out how to share his slides. My name is Taylor McClendon, and I'm the manager of the Health Data Research Network Canada Pragmatic Trials Training Program. I hold appointments at ICES Western, HDRN Canada, and the London Health Sciences Center. And I'm also appointed in Epi and Biostats at Western. So just very briefly here, Amit's going to start us off by talking about pragmatic trials, and then he'll dive into a specific example of a multi-jurisdictional pragmatic trial taking place in Canada, known as DIAL-MAG. Scott will talk about a multi-province pragmatic trial known as BEDMED, which is rolled out over 5 Canadian provinces. And then Kristen will talk about the preferred trial, which has aspirations to go multi-provincial in the future. And last, but certainly not least, is as the title of the session shows, I will wrap up by discussing the pragmatic trials training program. And just for the sake of showing how beautiful these slides look, which you weren't able to see before, again, you're in workshop number 2 at the ICES Research Forum 2023. I'm joined by Amit, Scott, and Kristen. We're really appreciative to work, live, and play on the unceded territories of the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people across Canada. And this is what you're going to be seeing today. So with that, I will stop sharing my slides and hand it over to Dr. Amit Garg.
Hi, thank you. Thank you, Taylor. So I have my slides up. Just I'll do a check. Can you see them? Yeah, perfect. I felt like I was in Inception seeing Taylor's initial slides. It was like slides within slides within slides. So it was great. So it's a real pleasure to participate in this session because it's really an exciting time. I think there's a real opportunity to use our data assets in Canada, which are organized through Health Data Research Network Canada, to realize the opportunity of doing more randomized controlled trials. And what we want to do is leverage HDRN Canada administrative data and its member organizations' data. That includes the algorithms, the data, the expertise, and the collaborations to enable more randomized controlled trials. And if we think about it in terms of our principles and purpose, and then the processes to realize what we want to achieve, what we want ultimately is satisfied and successful randomized controlled trial teams. We want to do this efficiently, that's both timely and economical. We want high quality control. We want managed risk, particularly privacy risk. We want to be attentive to equity and community concerns and be aligned with what the community expects. And we want these to be multi-regional, ideally, and the processes possibly that scale internationally. And the goal is that we'd have more Canadian-led, high-quality, high-impact randomized controlled trials, addressing the priority needs of Canadians. So first consideration is that we can use the observational data to better plan high quality randomized controlled trials. So many people may know there's the Data Access Support Hub or DASH on HDRN Canada website. And so In terms of informing a trial, you can conduct analyses, multi-jurisdictional analyses, to understand practice patterns, expected baseline characteristics and event rates, and inform preferred locations for recruitment. And after the trial, you can see how patients in a trial compare to patients with the condition of interest and how there have been changes in practice patterns based on the results of the trial. Also, there's the opportunity potentially to use these administrative data even during a trial to understand and survey what's happening. And so there's the opportunity to show value with exemplars and case studies of what's possible in the administrative data when it comes to trials. And ideally, there's an interest in optimizing a service model for trials within the Data Access Support Hub. And so I was asked also to give a framework for pragmatic trials. Pragmatic trials have a number of definitions, and sometimes you know it when you see it. And so each month now, large trials, pragmatic trials, using existing data embedded in routine healthcare delivery now appear in top journals. So to give you a sense of what we're talking about, within ICS, Doug Lee, who did the forum last year in the pragmatic trials space, published in the New England Journal just this year, a step wedge cluster RCT of point of care algorithm to risk stratify patients with acute heart failure, about 5,400 patients. There was 8,700 individual patient RCT of blood transfusion that also appeared in the New England Journal just a month ago. That was all done outcome ascertainment through administrative data. I was involved in a trial with others in the hemodialysate temperature. That was 15,000 patient, 84 hemodialysis centers in Ontario, and that was published late last year. There was a step-wedged randomized controlled trial of a multi-component strategy to prevent acute kidney injury after coronary angiography, 7,500 patients in JAMA last year through Alberta. And today you're going to hear about multi-regional randomized controlled trials and where they're at. Dr. Scott Garrison is following my presentation. He'll be talking about BedMed. And in this presentation, I'll be talking about the DIALMAG trial. And so for pragmatic trials, there is something called the Pressy two wheel, where you can look at the dimensions of pragmatism and see how your trial's fitting in on that. Really, but what we're talking about here are trials ideally embedded in routine care, where possibly the baseline characteristics and outcomes all come from administrative data. And potentially there's no research coordinators at the sites. And for some types of questions and interventions, if this technique is sound, it can dramatically reduce the cost and time of conducting a large multi-center trial. And so Taylor mentioned he's going to be talking about the Pragmatic Trials training program that we have, which many of the people on this call are involved with, to help support new trial teams and capacity in our community to conduct these types of trials. And so going on to the dialysate magnesium trial, this is funded through the CIHR Strategy for Patient-Oriented Research Innovative Clinical Trial Grant. And to tell you a little bit about it, for each hemodialysis treatment, there's a concentration of magnesium in the dialysis fluids, which we call the dialysate. And the three concentrations of Canada are 0.38, 0.5, and 0.75. The concentration used in the hemodialysis centers is usually a center-wide policy, and it's set by the hemodialysis director. And in Canada, it turns out a quarter of centers use 0.38, a quarter 0.5, a quarter 0.75, and a quarter mixed. All three concentrations are Health Canada approved, and in terms of the manufacturing, cost the same. The dialysate is provided by three different manufacturers in Canada. And a dialysis center typically has a contract with the manufacturer. So it's often the manufacturer's availability that dictates what is used in a center. Patients are unaware of the magnesium that's being used in their dialysate. There's about 30 components of dialysis. And when we provide care, we don't talk about each of the individual elements in the background. We talk about whether they consent to receive dialysis. And then when we meet with patients on rounds, and I'm a dialysis director, we ask how people are doing. We're trying to see if we can get them transplanted, et cetera. We don't talk about the concentration of magnesium. And even it turns out many nephrologists are unaware of it too, because it's a part of something in the background being organized by the hemodialysis director. And there's no consensus of which option is best for patient health. And this can be said for a lot of areas of medicine. And similarly, for a lot of areas of medicine, there's some data that perhaps suggest one option is better than the other. And here, in this case, a higher versus lower concentration of dialysate magnesium may be beneficial. Because when you increase the dialysate magnesium concentration, that's an effective and easy way to increase the serum magnesium. And a higher serum magnesium is associated with a reduced risk of adverse outcomes, such as death, cardiovascular disease, muscle cramps, and fractures. However, the overall quality of evidence for this assertion is low. Almost 90% of the decisions that we make in hemodialysis care are not supported by high quality evidence. And some estimates in medicine as a whole, it's 75%. So there's a strong need to be doing trials. And given the current method by doing trials is so expensive and complex, there's a need to innovate so that we can generate high quality evidence, which strengthens medical care as a whole. So on this basis that I just provided, we're doing the DIALMAG trial to determine if adopting a default center-wide policy of a higher dialysate magnesium of 0.75 is superior to lower dialysate magnesium, less than or equal to 0.5, and reducing the rate of all-cause mortality or cardiovascular hospital admissions, and reducing the symptoms of muscle cramps. And the intent is to influence the decision of what default center-wide policies a dialysis director should use. This is a cluster randomized control trial where we randomly allocated 130 hemodialysis center clusters to each of the two groups. The trial is taking place in BC, Alberta, Manitoba, and Ontario. And in terms of the design, it's innovative and pragmatic, implemented as a part of a learning healthcare system. We use the technique called covariate constrained randomization to create equal groups on measured baseline characteristics. There's no magic about randomization. And if you have a sample of 137 clusters, it's possible that you could get baseline imbalances by chance alone. And so if you see difference in the groups, it could be due to this baseline imbalance. So that's why we use this covariate constrained randomization approach. It's registry based. And in this audience, you know, this is then based in administrative data. Most baseline and outcome information are coming from the existing databases. The question about muscle cramps is being a single question being asked Q6 months in the centers. It's embedded in routine care. It's designed not to have any research coordinators of the 137 centers. The cluster design also reduces the risk of possible contamination bias. And really, it's also important for the implementation. Hemodialysis centers have contracts with manufacturers. Creating different contracts, managing the supply chain is a big deal, which I'll talk about. It's approved to have no or opt-out consent. And so that means patients with significant comorbidities are in the trial. In terms of an equity consideration, the trial results will have this diverse population in it. The protocol was developed substantially with patient partners. And this approach is allowing us to generate high quality information at the fraction of the cost of a usual trial. And over the 4-year trial period, we expect to study 25,000 patients on hemodialysis, 8 million hemodialysis treatments. In follow-up, because we can analyze the existing data, you know exactly what's likely to happen. We anticipate 6% of patients will receive a kidney transplant in follow-up, and 8% will transition to home dialysis. And our primary analysis will use an intention-to-treat approach. In terms of prepping for this trial, we analyzed data from these four provinces, and that data was also used to perform the randomization. In terms of the outcomes, one question may be, does this mean you're going to have to do meta-analyses of the provincial level estimates because of data sharing considerations that currently exist in Canada? And that's not necessarily true. We're looking at sharing model-based information across the regions, and that might provide us more precision than just doing the meta-analysis of provincial-level estimates. We're considering the possibility of federated analyses, and if a single safety data haven does occur in the future, that would be a welcome opportunity to do this as well. So talking about some of the considerations if you wanted to do these two trials, I'll focus on two things. One is, first of all, the ethics. In DIALMAG, dialysis centers are the clusters. Cluster RCTs at hemodialysis centers raise complex ethical issues. We have the privilege of caring for very vulnerable patients. This is a life-sustaining therapy. And so there are many things that need to be thought through. So in terms of being aware of the trial, patients are notified about DialMag through posters and pamphlets that are circulated every 6 months. The dialysis director needed private consent for the DialMag participation. In some centers, a patient or their nephrologist can decide to opt out of the randomly allocated center-wide default policy. And they can opt out of the muscle cramp data, but they can't opt out of de-identified health records. And there's no documentation of consent to trial participation. We just use the administrative data to know who's in a center at a given time. The reason why I said only some centers can opt out is that some centers use centralized dialysate delivery. We have these large barrels. And so it's an infrastructure part of the dialysis unit. And so if they change their magnesium concentration, it's not possible to even, it supplies all the chairs in the unit. So it's not even possible to have individualized aspects of this. And that's not what's done in routine care. So that's why I say some centers can allow for opt out of the treatment. In terms of the notifications, we have posters in each of the units. And patients are notified about DialMag through the pamphlets, as I mentioned, that are provided every 6 months. We monitor that the dialysis centers are handing these out. And every time we ask that single question on muscle cramps, which is de-identified, they're reminded that they're in a trial. We've translated the information into 19 languages, including Cree. But we are trusting the dialysis centers to communicate information to patients using best practices they usually should use. So if someone lacks capacity, that they're sharing this information with their substitute decision maker. If someone cannot read, that they're making verbal explanations, etc. When we think about designing these trials, many people refer to the Tri-Council Policy Statement for the Ethical Conduct of Research Involving Humans, the TCPS2, the 2022 version. And Articles 3.1 to 3.5 describe the consent process, which is patient choice. And so it should be voluntary, and people shouldn't be disadvantaged if they decide not to participate in a trial in terms of their health care. It should be informed, and there should be an ongoing process. So the approach we're using in DialMag is attempting to be responsible but balancing what is feasible and also comprehensive. Also, patients should be notified if there are incidental findings from the trial, and the consent process should precede the collection of research data, ideally, which is less relevant administrative data because it's always being collected regardless of a trial being done. Article 3.12 also refers to the consent being documented. And as I mentioned, in this trial, we're not documenting consent. In the Tri-Council policy, there is also Article 3.7a that the REB may approve research that involves an alteration to the consent process. And so the REB approved our request for DialMag to use an altered patient consent process at all the participating centers. In order to, use this framework, you have to consider, is the research of minimal risk to patients? Are the altered consent requirements unlikely to adversely affect patient welfare? Is it otherwise impossible or impractical to carry out the research and answer the question? What's the precise nature and extent of the proposed alteration, and is that defined? And there must be a plan to debrief. And many of these things I would acknowledge is a bit of a judgment call. So just going through two of the criteria quickly, the research is a minimal risk to patients. In DialMag, the trial is introducing no more than minimal risk beyond usual care, because it's like switching to an alternate dialysis center in Canada. And it could be considered as similar to a quality control measure implemented by a hemodialysis director. It does not mean the intervention is minimal risk, because we're testing an outcome of mortality and cardiovascular events. And all interventions have some risk, and some risks are unknown until the trial is completed. When we say it's otherwise impossible and practical to carry out the research to answer the question, this is again a judgment call, because some research is possible with many more resources, but we don't live in this world, particularly for interventions like this where there's no private sector interest in it. And if each trial requires over $10 to $20 million to complete, I think we should just accept we can't practice evidence-based medicine. We cannot, it's not possible to generate the evidence for most interventions in care. So we're trying to innovate in this space. When we set a center-wide policy, it also affects the care of future patients. So you can't even go and obtain their consent before they actually initiate dialysis in a center. And also in an open label cluster randomized controlled trial, if you obtain consent after the random allocation, there's the possibility of differential participation in the arms, which introduces bias. And so this was demonstrated in one of my esteemed colleagues' trials called the high-low trial, which was a trial, cluster trial of blood level phosphate and what targeted should be in people on hemodialysis. And so it was originally executed as a cluster RCT, and they randomly allocated the centers into the two groups, one to the low serum phosphate target, which is usual care, or higher serum phosphate. So imagine this situation. You approach people in the low serum phosphate group and you say, do you consent to receive what we've always done? I think you're more likely to get an answer, yes. Whereas in the other group, do you consent to a more liberal diet, which is something that we have not usually done, but may be beneficial? And some people may say, this sounds experimental. I already have enough to deal with. I don't want to rock the boat, so no. So you could have differential participation in this context. And actually, it turns out that it was even more complex because it also had to do with dietary considerations, which Dr. Wolf has talked about in other settings. But I would fully acknowledge the ethical considerations are not black or white and have to be thought through very carefully in the trial design. Finally, in terms of supply chain, this became a big issue in this trial. Soon after the cost of oil went up pretty dramatically and gas. And so transporting solutions across the country from different manufacturers became a big deal. And so we've had to work through that. And this is because we're integrating the trial in routine care. And so we're relying on current processes in which units purchase materials. So we've embarked on this 4-year trial period. We hope to report the results by 2027, and thank you for listening. Now I'll turn it over to Dr. Scott Garrison, who will present on the BedMed trial.
Thanks, Amit. Hopefully you guys can see my screen, and I'm not muted. I'm Scott Garrison. I'm a family doc at the U of A with a PhD in experimental medicine and an interest in randomized trials. I have no relationships with commercial interests of any kind, and the funding for the work I'm going to talk about comes from government sources, from Alberta Innovates and from CIHR. The network I lead is called the Pragmatic Trials Collaborative, and that's a group of regular family physicians in multiple provinces who are willing to facilitate pragmatic trials within their offices. And it's all about becoming a learning healthcare system, about having the docs have some simple things that they do randomized and using the usual care electronic data to look at outcomes and figure out how to use some of the tools we already have to better effect. So the particular trial that I'm going to talk about, we actually have 4 studies which are ongoing of different types. If you're interested in what they are, you can see them at pragmatictrials.ca. But the one I'm going to focus on has to do with the time of day that you use blood pressure medicine. This started with a Spanish study that was published in 2010 called MAPEC, which had reportedly had a 61% reduction in a composite of death, stroke, heart attack, heart failure admissions, and some other cardiovascular outcomes if people with hypertension switched their blood pressure medicine from morning, which is the conventional time to take it, to bedtime. That never changed practice in large part because it seemed too good to be true and because it was published not in a mainstream journal. And there were 2 groups that set out to try to independently reproduce it. One of them was in the UK with the time trial. And the other was our group here in Canada doing the BedMed initiative. BedMed initiative is actually 2 separate trials. The one I'm going to talk about today is BEDMED, which takes place in a general primary care population. But we're also doing a separate trial called BEDMED Frail, which is happening in Alberta in 16 long-term care facilities. They each have the same intervention, taking blood pressure meds either in the morning or at bedtime. So it's happening in the five westernmost provinces, so BC, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, and Ontario. The dots you see in the map here show you the cities in which we have physicians that are participating, and the table in the bottom shows you how many physicians have been doing mailouts and recruiting in those cities. There is a predominance in Alberta, about three quarters of them are in Alberta. The practices are, most of them are remote from academic centers. Most of them are participating in research for the first time. And that's largely, like, better than 90% of these people, these physicians, joined because they heard me talk at a CME conference, usually about evidence-based medicine. And at the end, I give a passionate pitch for participating in pragmatic trials, asking for their email address. Typically about 10 to 20% of the audience will give me an email address. And I've been doing this for about 12 years. For BEDMED, we've finished recruiting now. We've randomized 3,357 patients. The study is gonna continue collecting data until probably the end of this year. This is a really busy slide, don't worry. I'm not gonna be going into these kinds of details. My focus is gonna be on what I think is the take-home points for you if you're trying to do this work yourself. So BEDMED is parallel randomization, so randomized at the patient level. It's event-driven. So Alberta Health Services gives us roughly quarterly the total of all the outcomes that we're following for the population. We extrapolate that to what we expect will be the number of events for the province as a whole, and we're continuing until we match the number of events in the MAPEX study, which is 254 events, at which time we'll stop, and we expect that to happen this December. To be eligible for the trial, you have to have a diagnosis of hypertension. You have to use at least one blood pressure medication that you take once a day. You can have twice daily drugs too, but at least one once daily. You must not have glaucoma. That's a safety exclusion. There's observational data suggesting people with glaucoma have more rapid deterioration of vision if they have lower overnight pressures. Presumably taking blood pressure meds at bedtime preferentially lowers your overnight blood pressure. So we exclude people with glaucoma. We don't have explicit exclusion as far as when we talk to people, we're not screening them out for being palliative or unable to consent, but we ask the physicians not to mail letters to people they know to be palliative or unable to consent. So I will go into a little bit of detail around how we recruit through the family physicians. I think there's some good learning points in here for you. The physician offices are doing the case finding. So they're typically using their EMR to do that, finding people who have a diagnosis of hypertension. Some docs are quite facile, or their MOAs are quite facile and can do this easily. Some are very challenged to do it. One thing that we found useful, we approached TELUS, who has a variety of different EMRs. One of the EMRs they have, which is MedAccess, they were able to fairly easily build in a little button in the EMR that the office physician office could click on. It would find all of the patients who were eligible for the trial. They were able to look at it and remove people who they thought were inappropriate for the trial, and then hit another button and batch print all of the mailing labels. So if you don't do this, you wouldn't realize how important the ability to batch print is. If you're going to recruit a large number of people from one office, the real time problem for them is individually pulling up a chart and printing the mailing label. So it was huge to be able to do that. 16% of the docs participating with us in BC had MedAccess, 41% of them in Alberta, 86% in Saskatchewan. Manitoba, I don't know, because Manitoba recruitment had happened before we had created that relationship with MedAccess. SIPSIN can do something similar using the data presentation tool. So your Utopian group can do that, including the batch printing, which is awesome. And for the some physicians in Alberta who really struggled, the Alberta Health used the claims data to tell them who was who could participate, who was eligible in their practice. So once that list is made, the physician looks at it long enough to scratch off the names of anybody who would be inappropriate, just from what they knew in their head, not by opening a chart. We get told, the research team gets told, how many names are still on that list. And we send the office the same number of postage envelopes in which is a letter, and the materials you see on the right, a letter from the physician introducing the study and some study-related information. So the MOAs apply the mailing labels. The researchers don't know who the letters are being mailed to. Put them in the mail. Patients who receive it, if they want to participate, they call the number that they see, which reaches us, our research assistants, dialogue with them to make sure they're appropriate for the study, answer their questions, consent them if they want to participate, randomize them centrally through REDCap, and either they assist them with the timing change or more often they'll refer them to the family physician who helps assist them through the timing change. And then, of course, we track outcomes in the claims data. So when we first started doing this, the initial response to the letter was 4%. So 4% of people receiving the letter ended up being randomized in the trial, which was shocking because we expected it to be 12% based on the first ever study that we did, which was in BC and Alberta, where we were randomizing the time of day that you use warfarin, and 16% of those patients ended up calling to participate. I think it was because those patients were a lot older. They'd been through a lot more with their physician, probably had tighter ties to their physician, whereas the BedMed group, a lot of them are still working. You know, there's it's just not as easy to bring them in. So this was a big problem. We brought it to our patient working group. We have a 10-member patient working group. We brainstormed with them, you know, how do we improve the response rate? There's a bunch of things that we did. One of them was we hired a PR firm called Habit to help with all this. We created the logo that you see in the upper left for BedMed. We worked really hard to get the recruitment materials leaner, and changing the wording as well and everything. But leaner, one of the most important things for that meant removing the consent materials. So initially we had separate pages which were about consenting and a return envelope. We removed all of that and went to default being an online only consent process. And if somebody couldn't do that or didn't want to do that, we would separately mail them the consent materials. Roughly 85% of people who would consent online requires them to have an email address. You do that through REDCap, and you consent them at the first point of contact. It's actually really a great way to do it, and I encourage you to do that. The other thing in making the materials simpler, all the stuff we had, which was separate pages, the material about the trial, we turned into a single double width page, which was folded, that had all the material that we needed. Sounds like it's trivial, but when you actually open it up and there's only two pieces of paper, it seems much less daunting. We created a web page and a Facebook page so that when people received the docs letter, they could, my guess is a lot of them would Google it. They would see some information when they Googled. There's a place to go to. And we created a social media campaign. So ads, which would be targeted through Google and through Facebook. It's worth showing that to you. Hopefully this works.
Did you know that the time of day when you take your blood pressure medication might be important? A European study suggests that taking blood pressure pills at bedtime instead of in the morning may reduce heart attacks and strokes by more than 50%. The University of Alberta is leading BedMed, a Canada-wide blood pressure study, to determine if these findings are true. With your help, we can find out. BedMed randomly assigns participants to take at least one of their current blood pressure medications in the morning or at bedtime for the duration of the study. The study will then follow participants' health outcomes for up to 3 years by phone or online survey. This study could change the way high blood pressure is treated for millions of people around the world. Apply now or contact the study team to learn more. BedMed, it's about time.
So that's the long version of the clip. So the PR firm cut that up into four different shorter clips because the way that the algorithms work for Google and Facebook, they reward freshness. So if you want your ads to keep being shown, you need to be giving them something new. So we started with, 4% response rate. After all of those efforts, it went up to 6.9%. You may look at that and think, oh, that's such a small change. It's a huge change as far as what we needed to accomplish. So that's a 72% increase in the rate at which we were able to randomize patients. And then along with the funders agreeing to no cost extension, we were able to continue until long enough so that we would reach our target, which we will, in this December. For context, as I mentioned, there's also the UK trial. They're largely recruiting the exact same way, having family docs mail letters. Their response rate is 2.7%. So we're happy that we're more than double that. They didn't have the same needs as us. If you're familiar with the UK group, they have their physicians are paid to facilitate recruitment for research to do the mail outs. And they had several thousand physicians mail out for the time trial. Whereas again, we have 437 that were doing the mail out. Although all of ours are volunteer, they're not paid a cent. So how is this important to you in planning your multi-provincial trial? Well, if you're doing it in primary care, most people struggle to recruit family physicians, and I would highly encourage you to consider social media recruitment if you're wanting to do this in the community. We had about roughly 20% of the BedMed participants found the study online. That is, so that rather than the doc reaching out with a letter, they heard about it, and they're enrolling with their doc's blessing. We do check that the physician's okay with it. But without the doc having recruited them, those physicians are not counted in the physicians that the list that I showed you. Those are all people who mailed out to everybody in their practice that's eligible. We got that 20% with only about a year's worth of ads. I didn't want to do more than that because for a variety of reasons, I wanted the physicians to feel that this was their study, so they could feel, engaged and proud of the result. And really a big part of what we're doing is growing the network. So growing the physician network was important. I just wanted there to be an online presence that people would see that would bring them in once they saw the letter. You can target specific provinces, turn them on and off as needed when you're doing the recruiting in the different provinces. Facebook is way more successful at getting people to sign up than is Google. And the way that you target them, you target the people who have the condition, so hypertension, looking for things that related to that, but you also target people who are volunteer seeking. A lot less hits for people that are looking for information on volunteering, but the hits that you do get have a much higher rate of them signing up in the trial. So the mean person that's been in the trial has been in there for about 3.5 years, but the people who've been the longest have been in it for about 5 years or so now. Every trial is going to have withdrawal, loss to follow-up, especially one which is a long trial. We've had around 12% of people withdraw or be lost to follow-up. This data is from our interim analysis, which was roughly a year ago, so it would be a little bit higher than that now. But at that time, when people withdraw, they don't normally withdraw our ability to follow the claims data. So in fact, there are only 3.3% of the people whom we cannot continue to follow, which is amazing for a randomized trial. So that's a wonderful benefit of working with a data part, one of the data stewards. The outcomes come from administrative claims. They also come from self-report from patients talking to RAs on the phone, or if they prefer, REDCap will allow you to send them email questionnaires as well every 6 months as an alternative. Primary outcome is a composite of death or hospitalization for stroke, MI, or heart failure. Some of the other outcomes we're looking for include all-cause hospitalization or emergency department visit. Long-term care admission is a measure of loss of independence, which is important to older adults. New glaucoma diagnosis or self-reported worsening of vision. We measure cognition with a short blessed test at baseline and then again at 18 months. So looking for worsening of cognition, new diagnosis of dementia, non-vertebral fractures, a variety of things. You're all really familiar with the outcomes that you could potentially get out of the claims data. Regardless, as a clinician, of what you're looking to study, you pretty much have the outcomes that I'm going to care about most. That includes for long-term care residents, you know, separate from being able to use the hospital discharge separations, you also have the nursing records, the RIE-MDS data, which track things like falls and cognitive changes, problem behaviors, whether restraints, chemical or physical restraints, are being used on the patient, decubitus ulcers, all kinds of things which could be the targets for interventions. You can see how I've embellished this slide with the angel wings and the very clear statement that the Alberta Support Data Platform rocks. That is not in any way exaggerating how I feel. They have really been fabulous partners, really facilitated the stuff that we want to do. And we've really been evolving the model for the kinds of trials that can be done. I think if you're only thinking of working with your data partner for outcomes and baseline characteristics, I think you're missing out. The other three, so I've mentioned BedMed. For BedMed Frail, for another study we do in nursing homes, which is a blood pressure target trial, and then for another community trial called MinMed, the data steward is doing a lot more. So if I just use MinMed as the example, so this is a polypharmacy reduction trial in the community for patients who are over the age of 80 with six or more meds. If a doc decides they want to participate, they don't have to do any case finding. Alberta Health Services uses the claims data to identify their eligible patients, securely sends them a list. The physicians can look at that list and remove somebody who they think maybe they're actually not their patient anymore, or for some other reason shouldn't be participating. Then the data steward randomizes the patients behind the scene to a control or an intervention group, tells the researchers how many people are still on that list in the intervention group. We give the physician office the same number of postage paid envelopes, which is just a letter from them. We have a waiver of consent for this. It's not even presented as a trial. And the physician mails that out. The letter just says, I'm participating in an initiative where if you're interested, we'll work together to find the lowest dose of all your medications. Something which is already recommended as best care, which is why there's a waiver of consent. Patients that are interested book appointments. The data steward follows what happens to those patients over time, does the analysis. The researchers, if you consider, I consider that the data steward is every bit a partner in this research, but the pure researchers like in academia, we don't even know who the subjects in the trial are. So this is really a partnership that we're facilitating between the data steward and the clinician. And MinMed is only just starting, but we anticipate that trial is going to have over 1,000 people and be done really inexpensively and powered for mortality and morbidity outcomes. So it's not all fabulous as far as using admin data. One thing that we found, we kind of knew in the beginning was going to be hard, but it really hasn't changed, in the 5 years since we've started this, and that's that it's really challenging to get patient-level data to cross borders, despite the fact that we have individual patient consent for that to happen. So if you do, I imagine most of you guys are doing observational data, sort of cross-sectional stuff in those databases, and you have massive power to find differences. And that's not the case if you're doing a randomized trial. It is hugely important for us to get every little bit of power that we can. Being able to do a single analysis so that you can take all of the very meaningful covariates that we have in the claims data or that we've collected from talking with people to maximize the ability of finding significance if we're noticing a difference is huge. If we don't have enough power to prove that the difference that we see is statistically significant, our results are inconclusive, and we've wasted the time and effort and risk of the people that are participating with us. So this is a problem that needs to be solved. And I know the HDRN is totally, wanting to solve this, but it requires getting the privacy people in the different provinces, government privacy people in a room and saying, look, if individuals consent to this happening, why would you not let it happen? And to agree upon what the consent language needs to be to make it happen. The last thing, which is an issue, is that even if you do get data crossing borders, it may be that one of the provinces will tell you, we don't want you to share any patient level data which came from us with other researchers after the study is over. Now you may think, what's the big deal with that? It's a big deal. There is a big push for trialists to make their patient level data available to other researchers at the end of the study for a variety of reasons. One, so that you can validate your results. Two, so that you could combine it in patient level meta-analysis. But I think most importantly, because I may not have thought of all the questions that could be answered with that data. And, to get the most value out of the sacrifice that the participants have made in getting there, we want that data to be made available for others to ask and answer their own questions. If you did go to our website, you'll see a page like this under completed trials. There's InRange. If you look at that, you'll see there's a summary of the trial, the bottom line. But then on the bottom, there's a bunch of links you can click on: trial registration, published protocol, scientific abstract. But here you see analytic data set. If you click on that, it automatically downloads de-identified the patient level data set that we use to do the analysis. So you can ask and answer your own question. Our hope is to be able to do this for all of our trials. It may be that we can't end up doing it for the ones like I described to you where we're not getting patient consent. It'll depend. We still hope that maybe that'll be possible, but we'll find out. So just the last thing I would say is that you need to be sure to, in dealing with those two issues that I just mentioned, data not necessarily being able to cross provinces at the patient level data, and not being able to share afterwards, you need to be sure to collect all your data in duplicates. So not just from the admin data, but you also need to be collecting the exact same things in addition to others from the participants during interview. And you're not just asking, have you had an MI, when? You need to be getting, you need to find out from your the people who would be adjudicating the data, what would you consider, what would you ask them to determine that, yeah, this person really did have an MI, so that you get sufficient details surrounding those events. And that is all I have to say.
Okay, sorry about that. So thanks so much, Scott. That was a fantastic presentation. I was taking notes because that's exactly where I'd like to be with this trial in the future. My name is Kristen Clemens. I've been doing ICS research for over a decade, but I'm new to the pragmatic trials space. And I wanted to share with you the preferred trial, which is currently in pilot phases in Ontario. And here are my disclosures. So I practice as an endocrinologist, focused on disparities and multimorbidity. And I'll share with you one of the patients that I treat and her story before I tell you about our trial. So this is a 67-year-old lady who I follow for type 2 diabetes. She uses hemodialysis 3 times weekly. And when she was in her family's bathroom, she had a fall and sustained a hip fracture. She waited for multiple hours in the emergency room for admission to the orthopedic service and unfortunately was on the floor for 3 months because her stay was complicated by acute MI as well as ischemic bowel. And she fortunately was discharged to rehabilitation, but she did stay there for a couple of months getting back on her feet so that she could get back into her family's home. Now, patients like this one are at a very high risk of fracture. In fact, it's thought that those using hemodialysis are at least fivefold higher risk than those without kidney disease. And unfortunately, they experience a greater length of hospital stay, as well as a twofold increase in in-hospital mortality. And the difficulty for us as clinicians is that fracture prevention is extremely challenging in this patient group. These folks have very complex mixed bone disease that can be a combination of osteoporosis, but also is a combination of kidney bone disease. And we also know that in the hemodialysis population, many of our drugs are contraindicated, and that includes well-recognized bisphosphonates. The other difficulty is that research studies are extremely limited in hemodialysis. And that includes studies of drugs that actually can be used in this population. So an example of this is a medication called Prolia or denosumab, which you may have heard of. This is a subcutaneous medication that's provided every 6 months, and it is highly effective and has been approved by Health Canada for treatment of osteoporosis in postmenopausal women and older men for over a decade. But the studies that have been done in hemodialysis have mainly been observational. We've been limited in terms of comparator groups. And while there have been randomized controlled trials, these have been very small and explanatory trials, and they've been really focused on bone mineral density. And I've just illustrated that to you in the panel there. So it's really a picture of calcium in the bone for all intents and purposes. They also focus on bone turnover. And so we've really been limited in understanding how well this medication helps prevent fragility fractures, which is obviously the outcome that would matter most to patients as well as healthcare providers. So PREFERRED is a randomized control trial of a denosumab care pathway in those who are at high risk of fracture who are using maintenance in-center hemodialysis. And it is designed to be a mostly pragmatic trial. Our question is, does denosumab versus usual care prevent fragility fracture in hemodialysis under usual conditions? And the trial is very much facilitated by routine care providers, so nurse practitioners and nurses in the hemodialysis unit. And all of our follow-up takes place in the hemodialysis unit during scheduled sessions. Our intervention is multi-pronged, and this is for patient safety. And so what our intervention involves is really selecting the right patient, so a person who's safe to receive this drug, alongside administration of subcutaneous denosumab every 6 months in the dialysis unit by a dialysis nurse, early protocol-guided calcium and vitamin D prophylaxis that is also given in the dialysis unit via calcitriol, calcidiol, or adjustment of calcium dialysate, as well as close calcium monitoring. And this also takes place in the dialysis unit, very easily added to patients' routine blood work.
So this is just a table which shows you how we've tried to set up Preferred. So the design elements, we really have tried to echo what we would do in our osteoporosis program here at St. Joseph's. And I've compared this for you with the traditional large randomized controlled trials of denosumab in postmenopausal women. It was published in the New England Journal of Medicine many years ago. So what you can see is we are trying to use a very broad inclusion criteria. So we are recruiting those who are 40 years of age or older, who are at high risk of fracture. And we're trying to optimize their kidney bone disease as best as we possibly can before subjecting them to the intervention. We also want to ensure that they have no hard contraindications to this drug. So no one who's had a hypersensitivity, a reaction to the medication, or allergy, for example. The recruitment takes place within the dialysis unit. So our kidney care team, we have a site champion who's a nurse practitioner or a nurse who is approaching patients and providing them again with an iPad with access to a REDCap platform to view our trial video. And we do have the support of the site research assistant because of the busyness of the clinical environment around us as well. The setting again is the hemodialysis unit. And we are very much organized centrally, but the dialysis units themselves are facilitating many of our other screening and pre-screening activities. So right now we have our kidney care team who's helping with pre-screening and screening with the support of a site RA. As Scott alluded to, this is quite a process, and unfortunately, we're not able to easily identify folks without going through their medical records individually. And so this has been part of our challenge in Ontario with this new type of trial. Consent, again, is being taken by our central research coordinator via e-consent platform held on REDCap. And the documentation is taking place by the kidney care team. So we have simple to use bedside tracking tools that they're using to collect things like calcium. And those are being audited by our quality assurance specialists to ensure that we're up to the standards that our institution is requiring. In terms of the flexibility of the intervention, we certainly have some flexibility there. We do have a protocol that the kidney care professionals can use to prophylax patients, so adjust calcium and provide calcium and calcitriol. But this really is up to their discretion, and it's meant to be a guide to help support their patient care. And again, the follow-up in terms of some of the bedside outcomes and is in the hemodialysis unit, some of using our tools that we've provided to the staff. But our primary outcomes will be ascertained through ICS databases. So obviously this is a relatively new design in our center, at least. And so we are advancing a pilot study, and the aims of our pilot, of course, are to prove that our streamlined methods of enrollment can facilitate patient recruitment in a timely way, that there's good adherence to the trial protocol in a usual care setting. We want to try to ensure that our patients are adherent to treatment assignment, and of course that there's no signals of unmanageable harm that would really prevent us testing this intervention in a larger scale. And for some of the folks in the audience, you may know that this drug, when used in routine care, has been associated with hypocalcemia. Now we've been able to identify the risk factors when we've done some analysis of some of the previous studies. So we're addressing all of those risk factors in this trial, but of course we need to start on a small scale to ensure that we really are doing this as safe as we possibly can. So I'll just show you how we're organized in London, Ontario. So we're overseen by DSMB, and our central site is here in London. We do have a central research coordinator, as well as a research nurse, whose role it is to really help people understand the risks and benefits of drug therapy. And we also have someone helping with our data collection and analysis. As I mentioned, we were asked to include a quality assurance specialist. We recognize that this trial is a little bit different because most of our collection is taking place in routine dialysis centers. And so we have someone checking to make sure that it's all aligning with local ethical institutional standards. And then our trial is very much supported by the pragmatic trials team at ICS and Schulich. We have three centers up and running here in London, at London Health Sciences Center. One is finished with recruitment, and we are opening within the next few months to some of our satellite dialysis sites, as well as academic sites in Toronto, Ottawa, and Kingston. If Preferred proves feasible, this is a fracture outcomes trial, so we would need a lot of patients in order to see whether this pathway can prevent fractures. And so we've done some initial power calculations and we're looking at about 5,000, which is a lot. Obviously, what we would need is a very large multi-centered randomized controlled trial. And so again, as someone new to this space, what I'm really starting to think through, if we can show again that this pilot works, is really how do I go about recruiting multiple centers? I need to start to understand the ethical and institutional requirements across Canada. I would like to be able to use administrative data for baseline characteristics and outcomes across organizations and across Canada. And so obviously I have a lot of learning to do in this regard. And I need to understand how to advance a clear coordinated protocol and be able to have analysis that really occurs across multiple sites. We also need to find efficiencies. And so I listened to Scott's presentation with very keen ears. So are there ways for us to really streamline recruitment? Are there ways for us to streamline processes, especially for routine care providers, to help recruit patients given the amount of pressure that all of us are under with our own patient care? And of course, exploring models of keeping our core hub centrally, including models of central informed consent, are things that we will be thinking through. So with that, I'd like to thank our central team and the pragmatic trials team members that have been really paramount to the study, our co-investigators and collaborators, site champions, as well as some of the seed funding that we were able to acquire to support Preferred One. And with that, I will hand it over to Taylor.
Thank you very much, Kristen. And I guess the benefit of being both a speaker and a moderator is that I may potentially be able to redeem myself here with my screen sharing. So before I go any further, can somebody confirm you can hear me, see my slides, and that you're not experiencing inception? Perfect. Thank you, Scott. So just a quick recap, everybody. Thank you for joining us through this discussion of various pragmatic trials that are either already rolling out across multiple provinces, or as Kristen discussed, have aspirations to go multi-jurisdictional. So the idea here was to get everybody excited about the potential of these types of studies, and then to conclude the session with a discussion of the newly funded HDRN Canada Pragmatic Trials Training Program. So in the meantime, while I go through my slides, please feel free to ask questions in the question box, and we'll get those to those at the end of the session. So as mentioned at the beginning, my name is Taylor McClendon, and I'm the manager of this newly funded training program, which is embedded within Health Data Research Network Canada. So very briefly, I'll discuss what HDRN Canada is for those who are not aware, and then we'll dive into the nuts and bolts of this pragmatic trials training program. So I'll talk about objectives of the training program, as well as the different trainee streams that we will have built into the program, the competencies we hope to develop through this new initiative, and the modalities of teaching that we'll use to build capacity in Canada's understanding of this type of study design. And then we'll wrap up with a joint Q&A. So feel free to ask your questions for any of the panelists in the platform now. So what is HDRN Canada? Health Data Research Network Canada is a pan-Canadian network that works together to help researchers complete multi-jurisdictional studies using routinely collected health data. And listed here are all the various member organizations that are involved with HGRN Canada from coast to coast. So how does a clinical trials training program fit in to a discussion of Health Data Research Network Canada? So just to jump back a bit, back to May 2022, the Canadian Institutes of Health Research put out a call for funding from their clinical trials fund, and they wanted to fund three different types of initiatives. The first being a pan-Canadian clinical trials consortium, the second being training programs in the clinical trial space, and the third being individual clinical trial studies. So let's jump ahead from May of last year to January of this year, when CAHR announced the successful applications to these different funding opportunities, and highlighted in purple is that seven different clinical trials training platforms were funded by CAHR to train the next generation of scientists and researchers to conduct high quality trials in Canada. So the Clinical Trials Fund was $250 million, and part of that funding went towards, as I mentioned, different training platforms in this space. And the fifth listed here is the Health Data Research Network Canada Pragmatic Trials Training Program. This is the only training program that's focused specifically on the types of studies that were just discussed by Amit, Scott, and Kristen. And the team, which I'll highlight in a moment, with Dr. Amit Garg at the helm, were able to secure roughly $3.5 million to execute on this training program over the next 3 years or so. So I'd be remiss if I didn't mention everybody who is involved in getting the funding for this initiative. And highlighted here is, of course, Amit, Kristen, and Scott, who are principal investigators on the grant, as well as many others here who I won't have time to mention. And of course, many applicants and collaborators who do not appear on this slide. So I'll take this public opportunity to thank everybody for their contributions. And we're really excited to get this rolling as soon as possible. So just to create a through line here and explain the relationship between Health Data Research Network Canada and why a pragmatic trials training program would be embedded within this pan-Canadian organization. So just to make it clear, we know that pragmatic trials combine clinical trial design elements, including but obviously not limited to randomization, and they combine those design elements often with routinely collected health data. So we're at an ICES Research Forum, and I'm sure many folks are aware of the strengths and weaknesses of routinely collected health data. And as Scott mentioned, in order to work towards facilitating especially multi-jurisdictional or multi-regional trials, we have a lot of work to do in terms of breaking down different sort of political barriers or privacy barriers, as well as just building capacity and awareness around the potential for these types of trials and the types of evidence, high quality evidence that they can generate, which really speaks to Amit's point earlier on. If we want to make evidence-based decision-making, we have to generate good evidence, and we need to get creative and innovative about how we go about generating that evidence. So the Health Data Research Network Canada Pragmatic Trials Training Program is one piece of that puzzle to building capacity and understanding and awareness of the potential of bringing together these two worlds, clinical trials and routinely collected health data, to improve the health of Canadians and to improve the health of people around the world. So just as I mentioned, this is a national CIHR-funded training program. It's embedded within Health Data Research Network Canada for reasons I've described, and is coordinated by the Schulich School of Medicine and Dentistry at Western University here in London, Ontario, where I am based. And I have to give a shout out to Catherine Joyce, who's the Associate Director of Clinical Research at Western, who's really helping to push this initiative forward at the Coordinating Center. So the key players in brief, obviously HDRN Canada, which you can access and learn a bit more about HDRN at hdrn.ca. For those who are involved in this program and the trainees who will eventually apply, You'll get to know a lot of us at the coordinating center at the Shuler School of Medicine and Dentistry at Western. And the third player in this equation who's helping to grease the wheels and build infrastructure related to trials across Canada is the Accelerating Clinical Trials Canada Consortium, which is known as the ACT Canada Consortium, which was funded alongside all of these different clinical trials training programs. So what are the objectives of our particular training program? So first and foremost is to develop and deliver a national training program on conducting pragmatic clinical trials, aspiring to do trials that were discussed today, such as DialMed, BedMed, and Preferred. And these trials, as we know, are often, to make them pragmatic, embedded in routine care. And because of that, they're able to leverage existing data sources. And as we're all aware in this sort of administrative health data ecosystem, routinely collected health data is often but not always population-based. Often it can come from ministries of health. But you can also leverage clinical registries that may exist in different jurisdictions, as well as electronic medical records that may be more or less primed for doing research. And Scott talked a bit about this in the context of BedMed. And in this presentation as well, given this is a training program that's embedded within a pan-Canadian enterprise, such as Health Data Research Network Canada, we're going to focus on pushing the envelope with respect to trying to do studies, in this case, clinical trials that span multiple jurisdictions. The second objective is to align and support the other objectives of the Clinical Trials Fund within CAHR by creating partnerships. And some of the main partnerships will be with that consortium that I mentioned, the ACT Canada Consortium, as well as other clinical trials training programs. Particularly CanTrain. So CanTrain is one of the other training programs that was funded on that list. They have a large and fantastic team based out of the Research Institute of the McGill University Health Center. And we're going to be partnering with them and having our training program live within a centralized learning management system. So several training programs have come together to pool their educational resources together and synergize and reduce redundancies. And CanTrain is at the helm of breaking down those silos. So something many folks are probably interested in relates to the different streams of the training program. So we'll have a stream for what we're calling trial leaders. So these are faculty mentors who are focused on developing and learning more about the development of a pragmatic trial protocol. So these are folks that might be in the admin health data world, they might be in the trials world, but they're looking to expand their research portfolio into the pragmatic trial domain. And we hope to recruit those folks to the program and provide funding to support them in developing what may be their first pragmatic trial protocol. And we'll model that stream off of the well-established ICES Faculty Scholars Program. The second stream will be kind of the more bread and butter way of viewing funding, which is through postdoctoral fellows. So we hope to recruit postdoctoral fellows into the training program and provide them partial salary support. And as postdocs typically do, there's lots to learn as a postdoc, but there's also lots you can contribute as well. So we will be able to provide some salary support for those folks to both learn and provide educational contributions for the other trainees. And last but not least, we'll have a stream for HQP, highly qualified personnel. So these are folks that are already working in the public or private sector who are wanting to upskill their understanding in the pragmatic trials domain. And we'll be providing funding for release time so folks can spend a few hours a week within our training program for those who are working within the public sector at the time of being involved. So in terms of competencies, just for the sake of time, I won't drill down too much into this. But first and foremost, we're really prioritizing and embedding inclusivity, diversity, equity, and accessibility considerations into the training program from the get-go. And it's very important, particularly with administrative health data, to consider indigenous rights and indigenous data sovereignty. So within the grant, we have funding dedicated to supporting full-time staff members to support us on making sure we uphold high standards in these areas. In terms of ethics, all the presenters spoke to the idea about altered patient consent. So when you're administering randomized interventions in routine care, consent can become complicated, but this is also an exciting and innovative area in this space. Stakeholder engagement is very important. So patient partners, healthcare workers, if you're administering an intervention in routine care, you can imagine that you really have to have the healthcare workers on the front line engaged and bought into what you're trying to evaluate. So that's a huge piece of pragmatic trials. I'm sure the attendees here know well the complexities of analyzing administrative health data, and those complexities only get multiplied when you're starting to do studies across multiple jurisdictions. And in terms of design, methods, and biostats, Amit spoke to the Pressy 2 wheel. There's a lot of design choices you may make to make a trial less or more pragmatic, cluster randomization, stepped wedge designs. And when you do that, you have to consider those things statistically. So we have a lot of great folks involved in the training program, including Dr. Stephanie Dixon, who will help us build out curriculum related to these important considerations. I'm just checking my time here. So I want to leave some time for questions. Again, please feel free to leave some questions in the chat that we'll answer right as I wrap up. But I want to focus on the grand rounds. So in short, we want to be innovative and engaging with this training program. People will be getting involved and adding this on top of their already very busy schedules. So just as an example, through the grand rounds, we hope to kind of up the production value and take a different spin on this. And, you know, think of a podcast where a panel of people are informally kind of getting to know each other, but then drilling into a published paper or a particular methodological consideration. And the way I say this is I hope some of our training materials are something that people, you know, want to listen to in an evening or on a weekend when they're out for a walk, because we're able to create something that really pulls in people's attention. So with that, as I wrap up, how can I learn more and stay up to date? So I've been deliberately high level on some of the aspects. We're vetting a lot of our ideas through an advisory committee and our various stakeholders. So some things are subject to change, which includes when we'll launch the training program and when we'll put out the calls for applicants. But if you want to stay up to date, maybe favorite these two websites by Google HDRN Pragmatic or Western Pragmatic, and throw these into your bookmarks. Follow HDRN on Twitter and LinkedIn. Amit's Twitter and my Twitter will obviously amplify any major advancements in the training program. And I am also creating a bit of an informal mailing list. So for folks who aren't already getting contacted about the training program, but want to know when the calls for applicants are going to come out or want to become involved, just shoot me an email at taylormcclendon@ices.ontario.ca, and you'll be the first to know when some of these pieces move forward. So with that, I will just summarize. You've heard from Amit, Scott, and Kristen on three different pragmatic trials. There's an exciting new initiative that will be launched as soon as possible to build capacity and understanding and supporting people to do these types of studies. And with that, I'll stop sharing my screen and we can begin a brief Q&A as we wrap up this session. Thank you so much for your attention and thank you to the speakers for their contributions. Okay, so we're very close to the end of time. There is a question in the chat. When will the applications to the program be open to prospective applicants? Thank you for channeling that into the questions box. So to be determined, there's a lot of different training programs that were funded at the same time through this clinical trials fund. There was a soft goal of trying to launch by this fall. That is still the goal, which would mean that the applications will come out as soon as possible. But we also want to do this well. It's not so much about getting it done, but it's about doing it right. And we do have a 3-year funding arc on this training program. So what I'll say to that question is, back to that last slide, shoot me an email to make sure you're up to date when those calls go out, and follow some of those social media channels as well to make sure you don't miss the calls. So I'm not seeing any other questions. Do any of the panelists have questions for each other? Maybe I'll pass it to maybe Amit has a question or a comment.
Yeah, thank you. Again, this space is so interesting and exciting and quite innovative, and I really enjoyed all the presentations. And Scott, maybe you can speak to, I really enjoyed many aspects of what you said, and particularly the importance of creating community, using, you know, modern techniques to communicate information and disseminate information. And I think that's critical. Like, you know, you're creating a research ready community and keeping them engaged, and you're simplifying the messaging and keeping on message. I think these are important in everything we do, but particularly important in this space. So I just wanted to say I really enjoyed that. If you had any further comments on that.
Yeah, I mean, as far as the physician piece goes, actually, I'll give you my pet peeve, which is whenever there's the discussion about, you know, should you be randomizing at the patient level or should you be cluster randomizing? And I sort of had these debates really early on with what I was doing. And you'll often find people who are dead set that, oh, you should be clustering this, or you should, you know, and even to the point where I was standing up in a grant competition in front of the person who was clearly one of the two reviewers, and they were so adamant that I should be doing a cluster randomized trial. And I can tell you they were completely wrong, but I couldn't say that, you know, in those terms to them. I mean, number one, I'm a believer you should always randomize at the patient level if you can, for a variety of reasons. But to your question about building a network, if you're trying to engage these people and you're cluster randomizing, if you randomize them to do nothing, you're doing nothing with them for a number of years, if the trial lasts that long. Whereas if you randomize them and they're gonna have to see everybody in their patient in their practice that's eligible, you're potentially overloading them. So separate from all the normal reasons to do with power, you know, as long as it's not gonna be, you know, confounding, like contamination. Like, I get sometimes there's issues, but I mean, like, patient level randomization for us is the way to go. Plus also, there was at one point where I was contemplating clustering BedMed Frail, the nursing home trial, and trying to go for more than, we've got 16 facilities, like trying to go for more and then maybe doing a cluster. I would have destroyed the trial during COVID if I had cluster randomized it, because some nursing homes got COVID and others didn't. And mortality was a big part of our outcomes, right? So, anyhow, just if someone is out there and listening and you review grants and you think that somebody should do cluster because cluster is better, please do not carry that, you know, through as what you think that the trial should do. Let them, you know, have the flexibility to approach it the way they think is best for their network.
Yeah, and I would echo that. Like, the statistical inefficiency is, you know, like, we've done some modeling, four or five fold compared to other things. But I think you're highlighting, like, it comes down to also logistics. A lot of this is logistics and thinking about, like, what makes sense from a logistical perspective. And sometimes individual patient randomization, depending on the intervention, that actually makes the most sense by far and away. And you're kind of forcing it if you do it in a clustered approach. And also, like, you know, like, outside of the design of cluster versus individualized, there's also this the separate consideration, which shouldn't be mixed, is the consent process. And I think you also showed nicely the streamlined consent process. It is challenging. And, you know, like, in something that comes to mind to me is that, should we be also socializing for these minimal, like, you know, things that are being done in routine care, fairly minimal risk, where we want stronger evidence, there's no private sector partner. Should we be, like, we have a shared responsibility of generating evidence that includes everyone from the researchers to the healthcare professionals, like you're saying, to patients. And I see this, like, in my own circles, like organ and tissue donation, it's a shared responsibility. As you know, some places even are using opt-out consent for organ and tissue donation in the country, just because they want to make that. That's the expectation. You can always obviously do what you think is right for yourself, but the expectation is setting a societal norm. So all these things came to mind when I was listening to your presentation as well, Scott.
Yeah, I think consenting is hugely important, but I think people also don't appreciate that there's lots of opportunities. For the nursing home trials, like we've got two nursing home trials, they both have opt-out consent. And the case we were making unless we study it in this population, it's not going to, they're going to apply the results from the main trial to these more frail people. And most of them can't consent. Most of them have dementia. It's quite significant dementia. And loved ones are not, they can't legally consent their loved one into research. So it's either you have an opt-out consent or you don't do it. And for the community, there's tons of things which are considered best practice that don't have evidence. You can get waivers of consent for those. If it's already what's recommended and you're just going to say, we're going to reach out, we're going to do this in two phases. We're going to reach out to everybody in the beginning with this supposedly best practice recommendation that doesn't have enough evidence yet. And then in the end of the study, then like a PDSA cycle, we're going to find out if it helped. And if it helped, we're going to invite everybody else too. And so you can make very robust randomized trials around things that people already say you should do. And I think there's probably lots of, things to pursue.
Thanks for that exchange, Scott and Amit. So there's two more questions in the chat. Before I ask those questions, I'll just mention the main sessions are starting in 1 minute. So for folks who want to hop over to the main session, by all means do so. But I've clarified that we are able to spend a few more minutes within this workshop and continue just an exchange on these two questions here. And after that, for those who are going to hang around, the organizers will manually move you over to the other group. So I think anybody can answer this question from the chat here. It says, can the panelists tell us a bit more about challenges with obtaining approvals, so REB, and potential solutions to that, maybe particularly in the multi-jurisdictional context? So I'll leave that to anybody on the panel to speak to challenges with obtaining approvals, REB, and potential solutions.
I have one thing I can add. Maybe Amit has more, but for the stuff that we do where we're working in the community, we probably could get away with a single ethics approval per province unless we involve academic physicians as far as recruiting. As soon as academics are involved, they want you to get ethics from their institution, which in Ontario is a nightmare. And only in Ontario, pretty much, right? In Alberta, we had to do it in Edmonton and Calgary, but we have a single ethics application for BC, a single ethics application for Saskatchewan, a single ethics application for Manitoba. In fact, that's one of the reasons why we don't have more practices in Ontario. Whereas I think for one of the ethics applications we got, the people who had come to us, not going through Utopian, but we'd had some names of people in Ontario that wanted to participate separately, and we were able to use whichever ethics application we had for that. So I don't know if Amit or Kristen has more that they want to add.
I'll just comment on the Ontario piece. It's not been too bad for us here. Again, we have a smaller number of centers, but we have Clinical Trials Ontario. So we have our main ethics application through them. And then, of course, there are site-specific research ethics approvals that have to take place. I think things are quite a lot easier in the community dialysis units, in truth. So we've had ethics approval, no problem with them, with their local hospitals. But there is quite a bit more back and forth when it comes to the academic dialysis centers.
So the final question in the chat, it's kind of an all-encompassing question, and it relates to various aspects that you've kind of touched on already, is, are there any unique challenges, you being, folks leading these pragmatic trials, any unique challenges you face with multi-center studies So that could be multiple centers within a single province, or to add complexity, multiple centers in multiple provinces that are specific to the pragmatic trial design. So unique challenges that crop up with pragmatic trials in multiple centers. And the person who asked the question said, for example, center evaluation for bias and monitoring adherence to inclusion criteria and so on.
Maybe I can say, when you're trying to implement something into routine care, it's very fascinating how things differ in different centers. And so you think you have a solution, but then you have to come up with a whole other set of solutions. And also it's very interesting that there's a lot of strong opinions in the absence of evidence. And so, like, you know, it's, you realize, like, one, at least in the circles of things we've been discussing in our own research group, one part of the country will say, like, let's say we have an approach in London to doing some aspect of, let's say, dialysis one way. And then you have another center in Edmonton. They think it's potentially dangerous what we're doing in our standard of care. And then we think that they're like, are you, but it's all part of the standard of care. Like, you know, and so this practice variability has really got me again. I think Scott and perhaps Kristen would also agree. There's a lot of planning you needed to before you can execute these trials, a lot of implementation science things you're thinking about in addition to the other things. And adherence, also thinking of how you're going to maximize the adherence to the allocated therapy. Because at the end of the day, we're not quite sure sometimes you might say we're testing something that's really proven and we're trying to do it in a very innovative way. And so we already know that the treatment or the thing works, but most times we don't know that. So I'm concerned if we don't get adherence to the allocated therapy, at the end of the day, if we get a neutral result, is that due because the intervention had no effect or because we had lack of adherence? So I think thinking through that carefully, getting back to, again, some of the things Scott said, like, you can also use engagement with patients and have like a really carefully thought communication plan around that. And that perhaps can improve adherence to the allocated therapy too, if they're really engaged and bought in to the purpose and the importance of the trial. So again, thinking of that social engineering of the communication could also have a big effect there. But I've said a lot, I'll turn it over to Scott and Kristen for thoughts.
I agree with that. I mean, if I think of what the biggest problem we had, I wouldn't say it's multi-province. I mean, other than the ones I already talked about. But as far as like in BedMed Frail, so the nursing home one, so again, nobody's paid to do this, right? The facilities are all volunteered. So we, the data steward identified all the eligible patients, right? After they'd had a month of ability to opt out once everybody in the facility was informed. And then provided the randomization list to the pharmacist who should be implementing the timing changes. And for a lot of facilities, that happened right away. But for other facilities, they were dealing with outbreaks, other QI things that they're wanting to implement, whatever. And they did nothing with the list for, in some cases, it was a few months or more. Like, I think we had two that were like 4 months until they finally did it. And that's a huge problem if you're going to be counting time from the moment you did the randomization. So what we did, and the public protocol is not published yet, but it's submitted to the journal. What we've said is the way we coped with that was because they did nothing with that list. It just sat there. They probably didn't even look at it until the day that they finally decided to implement it. We modified the randomization to consider that the date of randomization. And if somebody in the interim became ineligible, which should have been equivalent in both groups, they were removed. So it's not ideal, but it's the kind of change that you need to make to still keep the results, I think, robust, but accommodating that it, you know, it has to fit with the facility's workflow.
Maybe just to highlight that we've had the same issue, Scott, in our own trials, because in a traditional trial, the interventions are available, you perform the randomization, and then the intervention is applied, right? But in these other types of designs, and you're managing supply chain, you're not going to start ordering things if you're not going to be randomly allocated. So it's actually not fair even sometimes to start the follow-up time right from the point of randomization, because they have no ability even to have the intervention be used from the point of randomization, right? So you have to create this lag and, yeah, like you're saying, justify it. And I find that the other thing is a bit different in terms of implementation. A lot of these are open label trials too. And could there be differential COVID intervention application things? But then that's a part of the implementation as well. And sometimes you're testing just a complex issue, like Krista made me talk about this. She alluded to this. You're not just testing the denosumab, you're testing a care pathway almost, because it's open label.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. Actually, one of the things that has been most challenging with this trial is across the sites, there's a lot of controversy about vitamin D in general, so nutritional vitamin D. And so we had lots of back and forth just to see whether we could have a little bit of agreement as to what a sufficient level of vitamin D is before we would subject people to the intervention. So that took a lot of back and forth. And just to Scott's point about pre-screening recruitment, you know, it seems to depend on the health of the people in the unit and in the bandwidth for some of the nurse practitioners to get involved. So we have some sites that are completely done and others that have literally not started. And that, I think, is just part and parcel to it being a routine care trial. And so we sometimes have to go with the flow there, but then recognize that when we do our result interpretation discussion.
Well, great. Thank you to those who asked the questions in the chat, and thank you all for hanging around for a few extra minutes. And of course, thank you, Kristen, Scott, and Amit for being involved in this ICS Research Forum workshop. We're looking forward to folks who are at this session getting involved in the training program, and we hope you enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you very much, everybody.